Archives are boring and intellectual institutions, and therefore have nothing to offer for me. That was a quote we got when we did a survey looking for potential visitors a couple of years ago. We kept it in mind when we started organizing the Memory Palace. The Dutch National Archives is the national memory of the Netherlands. The collection tells us where we come from and who we are, through almost 125 kilometers of documents, about 15 million photographs, and over 300,000 maps and drawings. Since 2002, we focus more and more on the general public, expressed in our mission in serving every person's right to information and giving an insight into the past of the Netherlands. We believe it is important to tell as many people as possible that they can acquaint themselves with their past through our collection. Because when you know where you come from, you might have a better understanding of the world nowadays, and it makes you stronger as a person. The collection of the National Archives belongs to every Dutch citizen, every taxpayer. Further, opening up the archives resulted ultimately in refurbishing the premises, which made the unique collection more accessible in various ways to a larger and wider public. The new visitor center opened in October 2013 with the inaugural exhibition, The Memory Palace, Your Head in the Archives. The aims of the exhibition were to acquaint the public to the wealth and scope of the collection, to give the public a very wide access to the collection, to inspire visitors to use the collection, and to surprise visitors in more ways than one, in content, in design, and in visitor support. With such a large collection, you have to make choices what to show. So the first thing we did was to formulate a general principle. We are not going to make a treasure trove display. We want to tell stories, the stories that are hidden within the documents. We started with consulting our colleagues with the underlying notion that they are the one who know what is important in the collection. They know our collection. We presented our criteria and inventoried all the ideas and subjects that had come up. The criteria which the stories had to satisfy jointly. They have to give overview through time. Different type of archives should have to be used to tell the stories. It should be possible to make a link between a personal story and a wider historical perspective. The story must be relevant and preferably have an up-to-date aspect. The second aim of the exhibition is to offer easy access to the collection. Finally, 11 stories were selected. We wanted the public to experience variation in stories and subjects, and offer a diversity as in festivals, where there's something for everyone. Can you please start the video? Yeah. All original handwritten documents were made digitally legible with specially developed software. In this way, we could also show the documents in their entirety. The visitor touches the sentence in a document and the relevant transcription of the line appears above it, with beside it the modern interpretation. Yeah. We often say that archival research is like a voyage of discovery. We translated this idea, there's a thing missing on the right corner. Well, anyway, just carry on. We translated this idea into a data visualization installation in which the collection of the National Archive is depicted as a map of the world. The image of the map is based on our database that contains information about the archives and their use. The continents represent the five main elements of the collection, the colored ones. The countries in these continents are a further subdivision within the main elements. The cities represent the archives. Visitors can explore this world in several ways. You can touch each city to see which archives are part of the collection. You can check the 11 stories and see which voyages we as curators have made in selecting the documents for the stories. You can ask for information on the volumes of the research in the archives. For example, you can see which part of the collection are frequently visited by women and which by men, and from which age. Another option to choose is to search for the favorite archival document of various colleagues and some well-known Dutch people. The data visualization, therefore, gives a view of the collection and also shows how other individuals use it. For each of the 11 stories, we choose an artist who interpreted either the entire story or one or more aspects from the story. The language of the artist is contemporary and brings the story closer to today. We worked with an actor, a documentary maker, a game developer, a landscape artist, a singer-songwriter, a cartoonist, a graphic designer, a sound artist, and more. The third aim of the exhibition is to inspire people to use the collection. Can you start the video? Yeah, and Mario, can you turn it down a little bit, the volume? Yeah, thank you. By asking various artists from different disciplines to work with the stories, the visitor can see what kind of expressions and products archival research can lead to. The artists were encouraged to market their own product within their own networks and on their own platforms. Theatre artist Jaime Ibanez, for example, has devised a performance on one of the stories, which had its premiere at the Ural Festival and has been shown in various festivals around the country last year. Actor and singer Ricky Gola, who we're hearing right now, was asked to write a modern version of the old folk song Once There Was a Clever Girl for a tale about women in a Dutch East India Company. She has included this song in her musical show, with which she toured the Dutch theatres this year and last year. This enables people who might normally not visit the National Archive to get in touch with our collection and our exhibition. Yeah, can you stop it, please? There's a series of seven. There's one on the behind the curtain. Believe me, there are a series of seven books to accompany the exhibition. And we started up an archive of stories on different themes and invited the public to participate and share their experiences with us and other people. And of course, we offer a fringe program with workshops, lectures, and other activities which offer different perspective or intensified knowledge on specific themes. The fourth aim of the exhibition is to surprise in content design and visitor support. In order to make a tighter link between the 11 stories and to put the emphasis on the relationship with the source, a partnership was found with Jan Blokker, a popular historian. His assignment was to write an overarching story in which the importance of keeping archives would become obvious. He turned it into a modern fairy tale and a metaphor on archives and a public function. It is a tale about a wise king who spends most of his days studying in the palace. One day, a few scraps of paper are borne on the wind and nobody knows what they are or where they came from. The king wants to know more about it and he sends the 10 wisest people to that far and strange country. After many years, the travelers return with stories and papers. As they each tell their tales to the king and one by one display their treasures in the cabinets of the palace, it seems as they are holding something back from the king. On the last day, it is revealed. This far-flung and strange country does not exist at all. The travelers went into the archives, and there they explored the past. At first, the king reacted angrily and disappointed, but then decided to open the cabinets to all his subjects and to give everybody the opportunity to acquaint themselves with their past. This storyline formed the basis for the design of Tate van Hulzen and Studio Lauter, in which the palace is reconstructed with archive boxes. This castle has 11 cabinets where the stories are told. The central oval space of the castle, with a table right in the middle of it as a wink to King Arthur, features the archive collection itself, transposed into the data visualization. The boxes are an allusion to the collection and the stories hidden in them, which are now revealed to the public. It is also a pun on reconstructing history with the help of archival documents as building blocks. We deployed several digital resources to support the documents, to make these more accessible, and to represent the content in another way. We already saw the software that makes the handwritten documents digitally legible and the data visualization, but we also used georeferencing to show that the pieces of land achieved by the convent of Rijnsburg from the 12th to the 16th century are still visible in the landscape today. We projected the pieces of land from the atlas on Google Earth. Visitors can experience the similarities by changing the transparency of the filter. We also integrated in QR codes in each of the rooms. By scanning these codes, more information is revealed about the archives which had been researched for the stories. We provided a guided tour for educational use on a mini tablet. Students were surprised to get offered a mini tablet in an archive, and they were eager to use it and start the tour. Now I would like to take you for a quick peek behind the scenes. The budget for the exhibition was €750,000. Just under €400,000 came from different funds. Now to the difficulties of the project. There were two separate construction projects. That has to do with the ownership of the building. We rent it and it is owned by the Dutch government. The renovation of the building itself had to be done by specific contractors and architects, and a specific process had to be followed. In that process, there weren't hardly any moments and possibilities to communicate with us or with the interior designer we choose to work with. The lack of cooperation between the two projects gave us a lot of extra work. The preparations for the entire project started in 2008. We had a lot of time to think and rethink our choices and selections, which was great. But the downside was that it was hard to keep everybody focused and enthusiastic during the entire process. The ambitions were high, as was the budget, but on the other hand, the budget was also limited because we didn't have the right infrastructure yet, not in the hardware nor in the organization itself. It was difficult to do the promotion of the exhibition because we were new in organizing exhibitions at this venue. There was no tradition and no brand awareness in the public. It was also difficult to capture the soul of the exhibition, because there were 11 separate stories, not one single subject. People didn't know what to expect in several ways. Easy was the cooperation with the artists. Out of the 11 artists which were asked to work with us, 10 reacted positive immediately. The proposed subjects were received with enthusiasm, and the way the different artists worked with it enthused us and gave us a lot of energy and inspiration to carry on. I won't use QR codes anymore. We had a lot of work on the content with the gathering and arranging of the information, and we found that only under 60 visitors use it. The program we choose for educational use was not good enough from the beginning. We had too little money to get the things we really wanted, so we tried to adjust an existing program. And we're still doing that nowadays. What we should have done was to think of something else, something completely different. We will offer more and different seating possibilities. And we will also translate more information in English. Next time, I would definitely offer the different levels of information and presentation again, and give attention to the details in the design and the construction. I would definitely also search for possibilities to cooperate with people from different disciplines. We did a visitor survey and found that the exhibition was well appreciated by the public. We scored an 8.3 out of 10. Now, before I end, I would like to give you a short impression of the exhibition, so you will be able to decide for yourself whether you can agree with the Dutch public. Please. Okay, thank you so much for your attention.